Welcome to Movies You Missed, the podcast hosted by me, Jace Cudlin, where we break down movies that, as you know, you might have missed. You know, you might have never heard of them, but never seen them. Never wanted to see them, but should have. That's what we talk about here. So yeah, here we go. This week's episode, brought to you by Squarespace. Just kidding, I don't have sponsors. I'd love sponsors. Squarespace, if you want to sponsor me, don't get it twisted. I'll take the money. Also, can I say Squarespace this much without their licensing? I don't really know how that stuff works. We're here to talk about Friday the 13th, Part 5, A New Beginning today. And for that, I'm sorry, only because I keep telling you we're doing movies, and then the next week we're not doing the movie I said we were going to do. But what can I say, you know? I'm just flowing with the breeze here. You know, I'm in a nice free fall, and I just go where the wind takes me, you know? I'm probably incredibly bipolar, but, you know, I watch the movies I feel like watching. I don't like being tied down by any sort of obligation. And I know I do have an obligation, of course, responsibility, even to you, the fans. But, you know, we'll get to The Awakening. We'll get to Prophecy. Don't worry. You know, they're on my radar. I actually had checked out Prophecy from the, local library. Had it for 2 weeks without watching it, had to return it, you know? Because I get these bright ideas, but then I get distracted by a million other movies that exist, you know? And I, in classic fashion, went on like a Friday the 13th binge, because those movies are just incredible. A true masterpiece of cinema. Not a masterpiece of cinema, but just like schlock and fun movie making and just a fun movie experience. They're just enjoyable films to watch, you know. I'm partial to horror, as you will find out. But I just really enjoy the Friday the 13th movies, especially, because I think Jason Voorhees is, the best killer, easily. I think he kills people in the most creative ways. I think his movies, struggle, like they walk this fine line between like being actually really good slasher movies and just like the silliest, most batshit crazy movies you've ever seen. And this is right at the end of that spectrum, being this movie is a batshit insane movie. Hated by most. Almost all. Everyone I've ever talked to, everything I've ever read online, indicates that people, fans, critics, you name it, they despise this movie. A lot of times, even if you like Friday the 13th, you don't even like this one, which, I don't know, I don't get, you know, I think so many of them have so much to love. This one especially, sure, it's scummy, it's kind of, you know, walking the line between movie and pornography at times, but it's got a lot of fun stuff too, I think. A lot of really enjoyable moments, and we're going to discuss those moments here today. So Friday the 13th, A New Beginning, Wikipedia dubs a psychological slasher film. Whether it really lives up to the psychological part of that description. You know, I mean, it's not Silence of the Lambs, you know. It's really not a psychological thriller in any way. That's a bold claim, Wikipedia, but it's a slasher film, okay? And it's directed by Danny Steinmann, and stars Melanie Kinnaman, John Sheppard, and Shavar Ross. Of course, it is the fifth film in the Friday the 13th franchise. And it is set several years after the events of Friday the 13th, the final chapter. A far superior movie, but, you know, it's also Friday the 13th that everyone has seen. So we're not going to shed too much spotlight on it today. So the story follows Tommy Jarvis, who we all know and love from the final chapter, and then, you know, famously too from Friday the 13th Part 6, Jason Lives, a truly great movie. One we could maybe do on this podcast, I don't know, because I think you watch 1, 2, 3, and 4 Friday the 13th, and then this one kind of stops people from watching the future ones, you know what I mean? Like, this movie is good, and I love it a lot, but people didn't really like it. And, you know, you start getting to, like, third, fourth, fifth, sixth sequel, I think people kind of start to give up, you know? But anyway, yeah, the story follows Tommy Jarvis, who, as a teenager, is a teenager played by, like, a 30-year-old man, by the way, is institutionalized at a halfway house near Crystal Lake, and he must deal with a new hockey mask-wearing murderer while also simultaneously dealing with the trauma and being plagued by visions of Jason, who he murdered as a child in the last movie. You know, Tommy Jarvis in the previous installment, famously portrayed by Corey Feldman. But yeah, in this movie, he's played by John Sheppard, who is a relatively unknown actor. I've never seen him in anything except for this movie. I think if you look at his film credits, he hasn't really done anything much, you know, and that's okay. People, I guess, flow in and out of acting, you know, I imagine. It's a tough business to make it in. Sorry, give me one second. I'm going to take a slurp of coffee. One moment. Excuse me, sorry. Yeah, I'm having coffee, even though it's 6 p.m. Because I live on the edge. But no, I have to have two cups of coffee during the day, because if I don't have a cup of coffee at like 5 o'clock, 6, I just start to wane, and then I'm asleep by 7, because I am 75 years old. Real quick, I'll set the scene for you. It's Sunday, January 16th, all right? It's a cool 31 degrees outside, but I'm tucked inside in my bed, you know, looking out the window. My cat's here with me, as always. Got a cup of coffee, wearing a knit sweater with a flannel shirt underneath of it, okay? Cardigan is blue. Flannel shirt is a plaid blue and red. I'm giving you more details than you need because I really want you to be able to visualize it. I want you to be here with me as we go through this journey. But yeah, so I think, I don't know, you know, as some people do, last week I was like, you know, I should watch the Friday the 13th movies, because it's a great time, you know, it's a very enjoyable experience, and it just kind of gives you, it makes you, I don't know, I feel like I have direction when I do it. I said, okay, this is an undertaking, I'm going to do this, because there are, you know, if you count Freddy vs. Jason and the remake, there's 12 of these movies. 12 times an hour and a half to an hour and 45 minutes apiece, you know, that's a decent chunk of time, but it's always worth it. And it's something I've done twice now, and I'll probably continue to do it periodically throughout my life, of course. I first watched Friday the 13th, I think I've seen, like, I've seen the first two countless times, of course. I think I would try to get through the series. I tried numerous times when I was in high school, maybe like, you know, 7 or 8 years ago, and I would, you know, I'd watch the first one, which is my favorite, and then I'd watch the second one, which I like less. I remember when I watched the second one, I actually didn't like it at all, and I didn't continue watching. And then the same thing happened again, where I watched the first one, I was like, wow, I love the first one. Then I watched the second one, I was like, I like that less, and didn't watch them again. And it wasn't only until about 2 years ago, during the outbreak of the coronavirus in the United States, you know, peak quarantine, Amazon Prime said, hey, all the Friday the 13th movies, except for the New Line Cinema ones, are free. And I said, okay, this is what I'm going to do with the next 2 days. And then I just watched all those movies. And it was a brilliant, brilliant time. You know, I watched them, ranked them. And then, of course, I, you know, waited, watched other movies, other things. But then I decided to, you know, re-return to them. Edit my rankings, and boy, did my rankings change. That's all I can say. People who don't watch movies more than once, like my father, like a lot of people I know, fools. No offense, but I just, every time I watch a movie and I rewatch a movie, I always pick up something different, you know, and it always hits me a different sort of way. And then, you know, I may like a movie more. I may appreciate a movie more second time I watched it. Whereas some movies I liked a lot less. So this was like, this was started last week. 9 days ago. So January 5th. I started watching these movies again. And boy, did my opinions from last time not even ring true a lot of the time. This movie, the first time I saw it, was a surprise. I said, oh, this wasn't as bad as everyone said. It was kind of fun. And then this time I liked it a lot more. So I said, you know, I should do an episode on it. Whereas if you're Jason Takes Manhattan or Jason X, you fell hard. You dropped in my rankings substantially. Those movies, I almost dare to say, are bordering on bad. They're not quite there, but they're not great. And if you're the final chapter, or if you're part three, or if you're part seven, the new blood, you went way up. I'll share my definitive rankings with you guys at the end. Well, actually, I can't share my definitive ranking, because I still actually have yet to watch Freddy vs. Jason in the remake again, because I do not own them on DVD. But I'll keep you guys updated. I'll give you my rankings as they are now, and then next week I will give you my definitive ranking, at least for the time being, until I watch them again, and then it changes. Anyway. Okay, we do have some business up front relating to the previous episode, Congo. I was not able to find any evidence of a scene filmed where a monkey is shooting the lasers. It was supposedly in the trailer. Some YouTubers were doing research into it. I don't think they ever got anywhere. I couldn't find it. I scrolled and I searched the archives of their video backlogs. Couldn't find anything. Couldn't even really find reference to it on the internet anywhere, except for the IMDb page. The search, of course, is ongoing, because if these scenes exist, I must know. I will be buying a DVD copy of Congo and looking through the deleted scenes just to be certain. That thought only just occurred to me, but that would be a good way to know for sure, because if there's a deleted scene, it'll be on there, and I will find it. I could also try writing Gary Marshall a letter. You know, I'll figure out where he lives. Just write it to the address of his production company. See if it makes its way to him. But yeah, if you haven't checked out that Congo episode, you know, it should have been released with this one. Don't know why you would skip right to this one. I mean, you can listen to these however you want to, of course. I'm not here to tell you what to do. But, you know, it's there. Because I will be releasing the first five as a group and then doing week by week, as far as I know. I'll be honest with you, I'll level with you. Human being to human being, it's very hard to keep up with these. Because I think my last recorded episode was like 3 weeks ago. And if I want to do week by week, then like, you know, can't let 3 weeks go by. But it's hard. Things happen. Life gets in the way, you know. I was it was the holidays recently. Over the holidays, I also got, contracted the coronavirus Omicron variant. Knocked me on my ass for like 5 days. So, and that was tough. And then, you know, work things, family obligations, meals, you know. You know, but I'm going to try to be more consistent. Here we go. And we're going to try to have guests on soon, sooner rather than later. I would like to have guests on immediately, but my current living situation isn't necessarily conducive to having guests on the podcast. Not just my current living situation, but my current setup here in the studio, a.k.a. my bedroom. It's just not really ideal for having two or three people on one, you know, surrounding one computer, because I have an HP laptop and two microphones, and I do this from my bed. Where would they even sit? I don't know. We can work it out. But I'd like to get a larger area to do this sort of thing, maybe like a living room. I don't know. But, okay, sorry here. So let's get back to the topic at hand. Okay, so this film was released in 1985 on March 22nd, and it grossed $22 million on a budget of $2.2 million, which, you know, if you're doing math, that seems like a pretty reasonable take, you know what I mean? 2.2 budget, $22 million. Box office. Sounds like you did all right. You know, if we're talking millions of dollars, you got $19.5 million plus, you know, what you put into it. But unfortunately, this was a steep decline in box office receipts from, you know, parts 3 and 4 and parts 1 and 2. You know, part 1 was like a, you know, a sleeper hit. Budget was almost non-existent, and it made like $60 million, something like that. It made a lot of money. And this movie made significantly less, although it still made even, you know. But, and that's because, you know how it works. I mean, you come off the success of Part 3 and 4, both great movies. Final Chapter, some people's favorite Friday the 13th movie. And then, you know, you're so hyped up on that that you go see the next one thinking that it's going to be just as good, and then it's not. And then word gets out, and then people stop going to see it, you know? It's like, I think starting with this movie, I think box office receipts from Friday the 13th never really regained what they had with those, like, the first couple. Because, you know, Part 6, even though it got positive reviews, the first time these movies got positive reviews since the first one, Part 6 didn't do well at the box office either, because people, remembering how they didn't like Part 5, didn't go see Part 6. And then it goes, you know, part 7, part 8, part 9 is just diminishing returns. But yeah, it was directed by Danny Steinmann. Yeah, I hadn't really heard of him either. But yeah, he was a... He did pass away, so rest in peace, Danny Steinmann. Don't speak ill of the dead, Jace. But yeah, he was a creator of porn and schlock alike. He made some low-budget films, and then his first directorial debut was literally a pornography film. So, don't know where they got this guy. Because, I mean, with Part 4, they got, I think, Joseph Zito directed it. He was a pretty good director. He directed a couple other slasher movies that were popular at the time. And then, you know, Sean S. Cunningham directed the first one, successful director and producer, and then Steve Miner directed Part 2 and 3. He was a successful director in his own right after being, I think, the first unit director on Friday the 13th Part 1. I mean, he directed Warlock, House, both horror movies, and then he directed this hilarious, not hilarious, but like ridiculous movie called Soul Man, with C. Thomas Howell, where he, like, wears blackface to get a college scholarship. My girlfriend and I watched it just to see how offensive it was, and we actually both thought it was a little charming. We were actually disturbed at how much we didn't hate it. Anyway, yeah, the music was, the score was done by Harry Manfredini, who was the composer of, like, nearly every single Friday the 13th movie, aside from Jason Takes Manhattan and the 2009 remake. He did the music for The House 2 and Deep Star 6, as well as, like, you know, like 100 other movies. The score in these movies, great. You know, he created the Jason, you know, the signature sound, the eerie, you know, like, that's him, Harry Manfredini. I don't know if I did it. I don't think I did it justice just now, but, you know, I think you understand what I'm talking about. This movie was released by Paramount Pictures. Runtime is 92 minutes, which, as we know, is in that sweet spot, you know, between an hour and a half, hour 45 minutes. All these movies are, basically, which makes them also very easy to watch. None of them are even close to 2 hours, really. How did I watch this movie this time? I watched it on a DVD 4-pack that I bought on Amazon that has parts 5, 6, 7, and 8. And I have another 4-pack that is 1, 2, 3, 4. So yeah, I watched this on a DVD pack that I got via Amazon for like $8.99, brand new. I'll put the link in the show notes in case you're interested. And initially, I watched this movie on Amazon Prime. I'm working on getting my own copy on VHS, but these movies on VHS are quite rare. And if you want to take a look at the eBay page, you'll understand why I do not have them, because they are quite, quite expensive. Why would you have missed this movie? Various reasons. The slasher genre itself, not for everyone. Most people don't like it, because as far as depth and stuff go, character development, story, there isn't a lot usually. It's just people being presented so you can watch them be killed. I don't know, it kind of harkens to like a dark, like, I don't know, just a place within people where they enjoy seeing people get murdered in weird ways. I don't know, it's like taboo. And also, I think it makes you appreciate the fact that you're not getting murdered and you're alive. I don't know, I'm not a psychologist. But yeah, the slasher genre, not for everyone. Also a very crowded genre. They put out a lot of these movies, and a lot of them, most of them, are not considered to be very good. Don't get a lot of good reviews. Like the reviews for every Friday the 13th, except for like the first one and like part 6, are just overwhelmingly negative, even though those movies are actually, a lot of them are terrific and a lot of fun. You know, part 5 is pretty late in the series, so you might have missed it because you didn't really want to jump on, you didn't really want to buy in anyway. So, I mean, like, if you don't want to watch the first two, you certainly don't want to watch part 5. You know what I mean? And I think most people, and most of the time rightly so, assume that, like, sequels, especially when they get that, you know, the number of movies goes up, you know, the quality goes way down, and it's kind of diminishing returns. So I think people, a lot of the times for good reason, don't watch sequels when they get up this high. And of course, this movie got overwhelmingly negative reviews when it came out, and has not gotten more positive reviews in later years. You know, people have come back to it, reviewed it, and are still like, yeah, it's not great. Even though, of course, it does have its diehard fans. You know, go to the Friday the 13th Reddit, you will see. But yeah, most people consider this movie to be like smutty schlock and just not living up in any way to the glory of its predecessors. And I can't agree personally. I think this movie is a romp, believe me. It's an insane, not a thrill ride, but it's a ride, you know. I think it adheres to like a Roger Corman-esque kind of rule book, where it's like, oh, you need to either have nudity, a murder, or an explosion every like 7 minutes or something. And there's like so much swearing and provocativity. Anyway, and it's just, it's like a very dirty, taboo kind of film. It's not the kind of film you would want to show your children at all. And like, of course, part of what makes it not that great is I think it had to be edited down, by the Motion Picture Association of America to even get it released with an R rating. I think they had to cut so many of the scenes, like the death scenes and probably a lot of the nudity too, just so they could release it. I'd love to see an unedited. Isn't the word edited weird? I think Pete Holmes has a joke where he's like, edited has too many letters in it, too many D's. It's like, you edited. It's just too much. But I think an unedited version of this movie, like an unrated version, would be very cool. Like they did with Jason Goes to Hell, The Final Friday. But yeah, so various reasons why you might have wanted to miss, but hopefully hearing me talk about it will, you know, stir up some feelings and maybe you'll go watch it. And then, you know, now we can just get right into the beat by beat of the movie. And let me change my notes here. Give me 1 second. Okay, here we go. So, there, the movie begins the way a lot of great movies begin. You know, it's that grainy Paramount logo, you know, where the stars come up and then they encircle the mountain and then it's beautiful. And it's like old and grainy, just like when you were a kid watching movies on VHS, and it kind of looks like shit, but it's like nice because it's familiar. As it fades into the blue Paramount, where the details of the mountain go away and everything's just colored blue, it's beautiful. So the movie opens the actual movie itself opens on a small rain-slickered figure walking through the brush in the rain. It's like raining and he's walking through bushes, and he's facing away from you. You can't really tell who it is. You know, the figure walks up to a grave. And then we see that the grave belongs to Jason Voorhees, and that the person at the grave, pardon me, I burped, it's none other than Tommy Jarvis, played by Corey Feldman in a cameo appearance. Little Feldman at this time, of course, had made it big, and he was in the middle of filming Goonies. So I think they actually had to go to his house to film this part of the movie, because they wanted him in the movie, and he wanted to be in the movie, but he only had weekends off from filming the Goonies, so they came to his house and, like, set up, like, a fake rain scenario and, like, filmed this little scene. But yeah, so Tommy is at Jason's grave, and he's, like, and he hears voices, so he runs and hides back in the bushes, and then you see two grave robbers come, and they begin digging up Jason's grave. Coincidentally, you know, in my notes, I said, that one of these grave robbers looks exactly like actor Walton Goggins. It's not him, but it looks just like him. Jason's corpse, you know, when they open up the casket, is just covered in worms, you know. And, you know, he's buried with his mask on. I don't know. Things are starting to seem a little strange. And you see his, like, hand close around the machete. They buried him with a machete. But he quickly springs to life and dispatches these two grave robbers before turning on Tommy. And he's, like, slowly walking towards Tommy, and Tommy is seemingly just frozen there, like, screaming, no, 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 over and over again. And just as the blade of the machete swings, a grown Tommy awakens in the back of a car. And he is being escorted from a mental hospital, according to what the side of the car says. And one of the men escorting him, you can see because it pans to them. There's a person in the passenger seat who obviously works at the mental institution, I think, where Tommy's coming from. He's just reading a pornography magazine. So that's the kind of movie this is. There's just nudity and pornography for no reason a lot of the time. Who's this movie for? You know what I mean? Who's that for? Do people really act like that? Who knows? But it shows the car driving, and then No, it fades to black, and the Friday the 13th logo appears. And I don't know about how you guys feel about this, but I love when the Friday the 13th logo appears, because it's always something crazy, you know. It either is shattering glass or it's exploding. So this time, the Friday the 13th logo appears in white letters, big white letters against a black screen, and Jason's mask comes from the back and, like, rears in and crashes into the logo, and it explodes. It's, like, so over the top and crazy. And, like, it's, like, schlock on purpose. Like, it's, like, they gotta know. They're, like, yeah, fuck yeah, let's just make it explode. And it's so funny, and it's so cool the way that they really stick to this, where, like, every single movie has something like this. But then the mask, after it crashes through the letters, turns, and it approaches the screen like you're putting on the mask. Pretty neat. So then the adult Tommy is played by John Sheppard. He's introduced to the Pinehurst halfway house staff, which is where he's going to be living. I imagine now that he's like aged out of whatever facility he has before, or maybe he's made enough progress. I don't know. But you know, he's introduced to Pinehurst staff, which is like the assistant director, Pam Roberts. And then Matthew Letter, who is like the director, and he's like, he seems like a pretty cool guy. You know, he's got a John Lennon poster on the back of his wall. He's like, Tommy, we really want you to do well here. You know, we really want you to fit in. We're like a big family, you know, that kind of stuff. And Tommy is shown his room, where he stays for a while, and then, you know, you see, it cuts to him, and he's looking at a picture of his family, which, from the last movie, Tommy, like, and his family had a cabin on Crystal Lake, which is where they encountered Jason, and it was his mom, and then his sister Trish, and their dog Gordon. And the mom was killed in the last movie, but as far as Trish and the dog are concerned, no, they're not even really mentioned in the film, as to where they are or why Tommy is seemingly alone in a mental hospital. But, yeah, they're nowhere to be found. Not mentioned at all, except for, you know, this, their images in this picture frame that Tommy's looking at, sad in his room. So then Tommy is, like, he's also shown to have, like, a little pocket knife with him that he then hides between his mattress. So I think what they're trying to do, like, almost this whole movie is, like, paint the picture and, like, convince you that Tommy is, like, the killer. You know, they start with this knife thing, and they're like, oh, he has a knife. He's dangerous. What's going on with Tommy? Did he snap? Is he crazy now? And they're trying to sell you that the whole time. But then, of course, Tommy hears a noise in his closet, and then he is scared by none other than Reggie the Reckless, the true heart and soul of this movie, who is a young Shavar Ross, who's a little boy whose grandfather works as, like, a cook at the halfway house. I don't understand why Reggie the Reckless's character is there this entire movie. I understand he lives with his grandpa, but why would your grandpa then bring you to work with all of these, like, dangerous, mentally unstable people is beyond me. And it seems like, it's funny too, because Reggie, like, bursts out of the closet that he's in after, like, dangling a spider on Tommy's face and scaring him. And it seems like Tommy's been in this room for a while. He's unpacked most of his stuff, and then he was just sitting on the bed looking at the picture frame. And, like, Shavar Ross has just been in the closet, like, the whole time, maybe for, like, 15 or 10 minutes. Very strange thing. And then it's funny, though, because they do a callback to the last movie. Because in the last movie, Tommy was, like, a cool little kid, and he made his own Halloween masks. And he's shown to still have these Halloween masks in this movie, because he takes one out of his bag and scares Reggie the Reckless right back. But then Reggie the Reckless is called away, because the next scene is, you know, it cuts to outside where local cops are dropping off two other patients at the halfway house, who are caught on the Hubbard farm fooling around. So the cop that drops them off, he's the sheriff of this town. He looks just like Shea Whigham. You know, actor, character, actor, every man guy. Fast and the Furious movies, King Kong, Skull Island, a bunch of stuff. He looks just like him, and he's a very sympathetic guy with a great head of hair. But he warns of the consequences of Ethel finding out that these children were on her farm. And just like that, as if conjured, Ethel and her son roll up. And Ethel and her son are some of the kookiest characters in this entire movie. They're literally insane. This sequence especially that's just about that I will describe to you now is batshit. It's absolutely ludicrous. So Ethel and her son roll up, and she starts yelling about how the kids were on her property and how these kids are always on her property and how they should close this loony bin down. And she threatens to shoot anyone else that comes on her property. And then when the cop goes near her, she says that she has a bomb on her, and she threatens to blow everyone up if they get any closer. She's like this wacko character. And it's like Danny Steinmann was just like, hey, just go nuts. Do whatever you want. Just try to act crazy. And she does. She just, nothing makes really sense. But it's just like, hey, you're mad these kids are on their lawn? Just however mad you want to be, just do it. And she really went for it. Also, the woman who plays Ethel, they're trying to dress her like she's like a 60-year-old woman, but she's clearly like a 30-year-old woman. And she has a son who, I guarantee, the actor and actress are like maybe like 5 years apart. I don't know why they chose to do that, but it definitely is confusing. But yeah, so that scene, insane. And it's followed by another rather insane sequence. Because it then cuts to Joey, who's like a curly-haired kid who is at the Ethel thing, you know, gawking at her as she threatens to kill everybody. And then, you know, it cuts to him walking around the halfway house with a chocolate bar in his hand, trying to help people. And he's really, you know, they're trying to portray him as just like a nuisance. Because he's like, hey, I'll help laundry. I'll help do the laundry. And he gets chocolate fingers all over the laundry. And no one wants him around. They're always just like, beat it, Joey. You're such a dickhead. And he's just like, well, fine. But he comes across this other kid at the halfway house whose name is Vic Fadden, who's just chopping wood. For what purpose? I don't know. Is this like a labor camp? Is it the 1800s? Do you guys have like a hearth that you know, put firewood in to, you know, boil water to cook meals? Like, why is this kid chopping wood? Why is that a chore at this house? But yeah, he's chopping wood, and he is like, he's wearing like a sleeveless flannel shirt, and he's obviously like a burly gentleman. Seems like a guy, like a biker almost. Like, I wouldn't want to mess with this guy. But Joey, being naive as he is, badgers the hell out of him, trying to get him to help chop wood. And he tries to give him chocolate, and Vic's not having it. And Joey is like, scoffs and storms off. He said, well, you forget it. You're not going to get my chocolate or my help. And Vic just snaps, I guess. And in one of the most surprising scenes in movie history, I think, he just takes the axe he's using to chop the wood, and he just axes Joey right in the back with it, and then continues chopping until Joey is dead. He murders Joey right in front of everyone for offering to help and being a bit annoying. Oh man, it was nuts. Totally nuts. It was one of the most surprising things I've ever seen happen on screen, because I said, oh man, this guy's really annoying. Never has that ever thought, ever just then been like, oh, that guy is now dead. It's crazy. Absolutely bonkers. Couldn't believe it. So then, I mean, everyone's screaming, and then it cuts to a scene later on where the paramedics and the police get there, and Joey's background is kind of explained by the head director at the camp, that his mother died in childbirth, and that no one knows who his father is because he ran off. And then the paramedics go to, there are two paramedics, they arrive in the scene, they go to take the sheet off of Joey to load him onto a gurney, and it reveals Joey is like just mauled, you know, like Vic cut off his arm and like his head and his back is just like hamburger meat basically. It's really disgusting. And of course all the kids are like yelling and screaming because of how gross it is. And everyone's freaking out and mortified, especially the paramedic named Roy, who gets like this really, really just like surprised, shocked look on his face, like he's seen a ghost. And you're like, huh, I wonder why he would react that way. But then you're distracted by the immortal words of the other paramedic who says, oh, what a bunch of pussies you guys are. Funniest thing in the entire movie. And then you see this other paramedic, Roy, looking surprised and bewildered, and then it just cuts away. So the next scene, randomly, is two greasers broken down on the side of the road at night. So it's later in the evening. These are characters we have not seen before, and we won't see them again because they're going to die. Pete and Vinny are two neo-greasers from the 80s. You know how the 80s, I think because of Grease, like greasers were in again, and people were dressing like them. So these guys are literal greasers, and they're broken down the side of the road. And the one, Pete, goes to use the restroom, while Vinny stays to fix the car. And in probably one of what is my favorite kill of the movie, Pete gets a road flare lit, like the killer lights a road flare and sticks it into his mouth, killing him. So then Pete comes back to the car, going to the bathroom, and he sees Vinny hunched over the car, and he says, either you fix the car or you're a dead man, as like a threat. But it's not a threat, because it's a real sentence, because he is dead. It's very clever, actually, pretty clever line. So Pete gets in the driver's seat, and he tries to start the car, and even though Vinny hasn't fixed the car, for some reason, after like 20 cranks of the engine, it starts. Doesn't make any sense, but it doesn't even matter, because Pete's not going anywhere, because he has his throat slit from behind with a machete. A machete? Who uses a machete? But yeah, and then it cuts to the next day, and it's Tommy, and John Sheppard is just playing this role like it's in a completely different movie. Like, he's like a really good actor, I guess, and he actually, from what I read on IMDb, he actually went to like mental hospitals and studied mental patients to try to get like an accurate portrayal of like a mentally ill, damaged, traumatized person. So like, this scene especially, where he's in bed and he's like sweating and he's like, he's got like the covers up to his chin and he's like having like a nervous breakdown, basically thinking about what he did to Jason. It's like really, really sincere, and like, it seems genuine, and it doesn't belong in this movie at all. Like, he's doing some Jacob's Ladder type beat stuff, and like the scene where Tim Robbins is like in the bathtub, it's like, it almost looks exactly like that scene, as if Adrian Lynn literally, I'll be honest with you, I don't know if that's who directed Jacob's Ladder, but it literally looks kind of almost like exactly like that scene, because like a character laying down having like a nervous breakdown. This part alone belongs in a psychological thriller movie. And he's like, he's waking up sweaty because he's reliving the murder of Jason over and over and over again in his dreams. But like, seriously, it's good. It doesn't belong in this movie though. And he then wakes up and then he looks in the mirror and he's hallucinating Jason. Also, he's shirtless and he's like totally ripped. Doesn't really make sense. Like, they have this whole thing in the movie too where where, like, Tommy is, like, also a ninja. Like, he's ripped as shit. And, like, he has, like, a six-pack, and he knows karate, and he beats up, like, three people in this movie. But they don't explain why. Because if you were in a mental hospital, where are you getting this black belt in Taekwondo, Tommy? It doesn't quite add. You know what I mean? But yeah, and then it cuts to the breakfast table at the halfway house where Reggie's grandpa is making everybody breakfast. And there's actually a really funny exchange here where Reggie's grandpa is like, hey, all right, go tell everyone that breakfast is ready. And Reggie says, oh, okay, I'll go do it. And then he goes to the door of the kitchen and just screams, breakfast! And then Reggie's grandpa's like, well, I could have done that. And it was actually, it's a pretty funny exchange, actually. There's some, like, legitimate actual moments of humor in this movie that I find really funny. A lot of the stuff is, like, mostly just trying too hard. And it doesn't actually, I think, make people... You ever think about how people try in movies to make you laugh so hard, but only, like, a fourth of it actually lands and makes you legitimately laugh? Isn't that weird to think about? Like, if you think about every moment in a sitcom that doesn't make you laugh, sitcoms kind of fail, don't they? Because you laugh, like, once every... Like, there's only, like, once out of, like, every 10 jokes that, like, you're actually laughing with the laugh track. Most of the time, you're just watching. Isn't that weird? Anyway, humor's a weird subjective thing anyway. But, yeah. At breakfast, Tommy comes down and he's immediately scared and taunted at breakfast by this kid named Eddie, who scares Eddie wearing one of Eddie's own masks, or scares Tommy wearing Eddie scares Tommy using one of Tommy's masks, and then Tommy, after being scared and ridiculed, takes this guy in a fireman's carry and throws him into a table and starts punching him and beating him up. Again, don't know where Tommy became like an MMA fighter, but I mean, I think it's just, you know, goes to show you that he is mentally disturbed and prone to violence, because they're trying to make you believe that he is the killer. Sorry, I keep burping. I had a big dinner before getting on to record. But yeah, so people restrain him, and then like it's just more evidence of like, whoa, this guy's unhinged. But yeah, the scene then cuts to Ethel, who's making Junior breakfast. And then this guy comes along. He's a drifter. And he's like a surly, dirty-looking guy with a low, gritty kind of voice. And he says, oh, I need a meal. I'm willing to work. And she's like, well, go clean the chicken coops, and then I'll have a meal for you when you're done. So, like, this guy, too, is another, like, red herring that they're trying to make you think is the killer. Because he shows up and he's this random guy and he's showing up and he's kind of shady and he's like literally coming into the movie right as the killing starts. So it's like, oh, is the drifter the killer? This movie has a million red herrings. I'll do a red herring count at the end, which is a hilarious thing that no one should have to do during a movie. But yeah, the police discover the greaser's bodies and the paramedics are there and the police sheriff is, you know, with the nice hair is there, and he's like, man, they're trying to figure out what's going on, and it's like, there's this really insanely funny exchange that I don't really know what it's trying to do, but the sheriff, like, mutters to himself, he's like, man, what the heck is going on around here, and then Roy, the paramedic from before, leans over and is like, hey, man, are you talking to me, and it's so uncomfortable, because the sheriff literally is like, what, and he's like, oh, I just thought you were talking to me. He's like, no, Roy, just back up the body. And it's, like, so uncomfortable because it's like, are you talking to me? And then the sheriff says, what? Which is exactly what I'm saying, because it's like, what kind of interaction is this that's happening in this movie? It's, like, the most dry, uncomfortable thing I've ever seen. It's so funny. But, yeah, and, like, there's a lot of shots lingering on Roy during this scene, the paramedic, so something is up with him, too, and you don't know, but it's, like... insane. So then the next scene, okay, and I must say too, before I go into this movie is just a series of people being introduced so they can get murdered. Okay, I think at a base level, Danny Steinmann understands what people like about slasher movies more than most people who make slashers, because he knows that you want to see people being murdered in funny ways. I think he knew that, and I think that's why, if this would have been like the movie he wanted it to be, like where the Motion Picture Association of America doesn't like, you know, nerf all the kills and the violence and the gore, I think this movie would be like much better. But it, because like all these people are introduced randomly, and their kills aren't really a lot of the times that satisfying, it just makes for a movie that isn't really that memorable for most people. But I mean, of course I love it, because I think some of the kills are actually pretty crazy. And just the fact that it's like there's so many red herrings, but it's just like, yeah, like, so like this next scene, do you remember the guy earlier who was driving Tommy to the halfway house and he's just reading a porn magazine in the driver's seat? So we then go to this guy you never thought you'd see again is now the main focus of like a 7-minute scene. So this guy, Billy, who is like a balding man with a thick mustache, and he's no longer working in his orderly mental health, you know, assistant clothes. He's now in like a leather jacket, and he's got a nice car, and he's picking up a girl named Lana from her job as a waitress to go on a date. Also, this dude's arms are ridiculously hairy, and he's like, I don't know, he's very confident for some reason. I'm kind of drawn to it. But he's picking up Lana, and she's like, okay, I'll be right out. And then he starts doing cocaine. He hides his cocaine, like, in his visor in his car. Seems like a terrible hiding spot to me for anything. But yeah, so he starts doing cocaine while waiting for her, and then he gets an axe right in the head, in the bald spot that he has. Like, it's like a target, basically. Because it's like he has brown hair, and then you can see a circle of flesh, and then the axe goes right in the top of his head. So Lana is busy getting ready inside. Also, she's a very, very pretty woman, far too good for this man. And she does this thing that I guess was inspired by Bob Fosse, that Bob Fosse movie with Roy Scheider in it, where when she's changing, she takes off her shirt and reveals her tits in the camera, like in the mirror, and she's like, it's showtime. I don't know, like, who are you talking to? Who's this for? No one can see you. It's just and she suggested she do this to the director, and the director, of course, was like, yeah, totally do it. We'd all love to see your boobs. You know, the more nudity in this movie we can get, the better. Like, there's a lot of exposed women in this movie. I think this is, like, one of the first instances of it, but it's, like, pretty prevalent. And I think it was originally way more prevalent before they cut it down. So as she's leaving, she hears a noise in the diner, and it turns out to be a stray cat just inside the diner, which is hilarious, doesn't make any sense. But then she goes outside. She finds Billy's body, she turns around, gets an axe right in the stomach. So she's dead. So there's two people right there you didn't know or care about, introduced just so they can be murdered. But who's doing the murdering? We don't know. Because, number one, won't show their face. Number two, they keep using different weapons. So they're trying to keep you guessing. And at this point, you know, it could be the Drifter. It could be Roy, because he's weird. Or I think they're really trying to convince you that it's Tommy, although I don't know if they're necessarily doing a really good job at that. So the next scene is the next day, and it's Eddie and Tina. Eddie and Tina were the two horny teens from earlier who were caught on Ethel's land. And of course, they're now seen smoking and fooling around in the woods. So they have sex, and of course, there's more like gratuitous tit shots of this woman, who's a very large-breasted woman. So they're like making love on a blanket, and the guy, Eddie, goes away to go to the bathroom and wash up. He literally like washes his face in a river. It's hilarious. And they're all, while they're having sex, they're being watched by the Drifter guy from earlier that Ethel is letting stay with her for work. And like, so he can get some meals. Remember that guy who's just introduced? So he's watching these two people have sex. And then he turns around and is stabbed in the gut, like, with a knife, and dies. So, like, was he supposed to be a red herring? he was in two scenes, and he's killed off immediately. We're not even halfway through the movie. So, like, was he a red herring? If so, very inappropriate use of a character. So then, while Eddie is away, Tina is laying down. Her eyes are closed. She's very happy. And then she opens her eyes, and there's a guy standing over, and he shoves garden shears through her eyeballs. And it's actually a pretty gruesome scene, because he shoves it in, and you hear it, and then he closes the garden shears, and it obviously, like, closes over bone, and there's a crack, and it's pretty gruesome. It's probably, like, it was up there for my favorite kills of this movie. It was pretty nuts. One of the more gruesome ones. A lot of eye stuff in this movie. You'll soon find out. But then Eddie, when he's coming back, is murdered in a very creative way, because he backs up into a tree. He finds Tina's body, and then he's, like, so shocked by it, he backs up into a tree, and then a belt comes around the tree across Eddie's eyes, and then they put a branch through, like, the belt loops, and then start twisting the branch, which then twists the belt tighter and tighter and tighter around Eddie's eyes, and it, like, crushes his eyes and his skull and kills him. So that's a really creative, interesting kill, and I'm sure it was a lot more gruesome and bloody before they edited it down, but, like, a lot of eye stuff. And then, you know, later in the evening, Pam is there, and she's with Reggie, and she's taking Reggie to go see his older brother named Demon. Again, like, what are the relations here? Like, why is Grandpa trusting this woman, Pam, to take Reggie to go see his brother? Like, why is this something Pam would possibly do at all? Why is Reggie even there? Like, imagine if you worked with somebody, and then that person you worked with was like, hey, can you take my grandson to hang out with his brother and then just be there with them? Because you have to take him home. Like, what is the logic here? Like, this is just something that they're casually doing, but I'm not buying it. Who would do this for anybody? And then she's like, here, let's bring Tommy along, get him out of his shell. Why? Why would you bring Tommy, a mentally unstable person, to this random event where he knows nobody? Also, you just met him yesterday. And, like, also, Reggie's brother's name is Demon, and he's obviously, like, a biker person, but, like, everybody, including Pam and Grandpa, just call him Demon. If you're a grandfather, don't you just call your grandson by his regular name? Unless his legal name is Demon. I don't know. They never really explain. But, like, once they get there, I think one of the saving graces of this movie, actually, is, like, Reggie and Demon's relationship. Because Demon actually seems, like, very, like, loving and caring towards Reggie. And he, like, offers him food. And he's like, hey, man, it's great to see you. And he just genuinely seems so happy to see Reggie. And they hug and stuff. Also, Reggie's, excuse me, wearing this cute little red sweatsuit. It's adorable. But, yeah, they're, he gives him, like, he's like, hey, man, I like your rings, Demon. And Demon gives him a ring. And, like, he offers him an enchilada. It's really sweet. So, meanwhile, during this intimate moment, Pam is just there for no reason in the van. And even though they brought Tommy, he's not with them. He's, like, off to the side, wandering around, acting traumatized because he's in a completely different movie than these people. And he's not saying anything to anyone. And then Ethel's son, Junior, who I think is, like, a poor taste caricature of a mentally challenged person with a learning disability because he's wearing a helmet, and he has a certain type of speech. He rolls up on his motorcycle, and he starts talking to Tommy, asking Tommy what he's doing. And Tommy doesn't really have any answers, and then he's like, oh, you're from that nut house, aren't you? Also, they have, like, southern accents, kind of, even though I'm pretty sure they live on Crystal Lake, which is in, like, New Jersey. But, yeah, then Junior and Tommy get into, like, an altercation, and Tommy, again, I don't know why, but he just handles him. Like, he just picks Junior apart, just boxing him. Just boom, boom, landing multiple blows. And it's actually, I hate to say it, a pretty well-choreographed fight scene. Tommy, like, I don't know. Like, he looks like he's doing, like, actual boxing. It looks like an episode of Daredevil or something. And he's just dismantling Junior. And it's just like, and then, like, Pam is like, hey, Tommy, stop. What are you doing? And then Junior gets up and he leaves. And then Tommy runs off into the night. And then Pam and Reggie are like, we gotta go. We gotta go after Tommy. And then Demon and his girlfriend, Anita, are left alone. And then in one of the most famous scenes of the movie, Demon goes into a porta potty because he's having stomach issues. And Anita's like, oh my gosh, baby, are you okay? And he's like, it's them damn enchiladas. One of the funniest lines in the entire series. One of the silliest, too. And then there's actually a sweet moment where Anita and Demon are singing back and forth to each other through the porta potty doors. And it's a sweet scene, and it's actually a really well done scene because they're singing like lines back and forth to each other before Anita suddenly goes silent. And you're like, oh, geez, whatever happened to Anita? And then Demon opens the door and he sees her on the ground dead with her throat slit. And then Demon is then impaled through the wall on like a piece of rhubarb or something. Like a, I don't know if rhubarb is the word. Rebar? Is it James Remar? It's like a metal pole thing that you stick in the ground as like a foundation. It's like he's like stabbed through the porta potty wall with this thing and he's dead. A lot of people being murdered in this movie. So then Pam and Reggie can't find Tommy and they return to the house. Only to find that like Matt, the director, who's had like two scenes in this entire movie, and Gramps are both missing. You know, what happened to Gramps? It's not going great. Okay, so then it brings me, I'll just go over this quickly. The top of my notes here is the red herring list, which is Tommy, Roy, the Drifter, and then also Vic, because Vic murdered someone he was the first person to kill someone in this movie with an axe. So there's literally like four people that you're like, is this the killer? Is this the killer? Who's the killer? Almost like a whodunit of sorts. But then there's three teens who at this house now that we saw at breakfast, but we have not seen or heard from really the entire movie except for that 1 minute scene. So these people are again basically just here so they can get murdered. So Reggie is left within their care while Pam goes back out and looks for Tommy. And she also is looking for Matt and Gramps at this point, too. So Junior, meanwhile, enraged at having been beaten up by Tommy, angrily drives his motorcycle around his house, screaming about how he wants his mom to, you know, get Tommy and kill all those people at the house. And while he's riding around, crying, having a fit, a machete comes out from behind a tree and decapitates him. And then you see his severed head on the ground. It's pretty bad looking, but, you know, I didn't expect it to be good. Interesting fact, too, because I watched that documentary, Crystal Lake Memories, The Complete History of the Friday the 13th series, which, by the way, is a 7-hour long documentary. It's insane. But, yeah, very good documentary, very thorough, very interesting if you like these movies. But in the documentary, the guy who plays Junior, I guess he like shows that he still has his severed head. He's like, yeah, they let me keep it. It's pretty cool. Looks nothing like me though. So yeah, it's cool that I don't know. If they ever made a severed, like a mold of a severed head of me, I would definitely want to keep it. So he's dead. And then Ethel is like cleaved in the face through a window as she's cooking a stew. And she has a tomato in her hand, and as she's cleaved in the face, she, like, spasms and, like, squeezes a tomato until it bursts, which is pretty cool. But it also just kind of reminds me of the previous Friday the 13th kill where the girl, like, squeezes the banana so hard that it, like, squishes and falls out of the peel. I don't remember if that was if that was final chapter or part three. I think it might have been part three. So then it sorry, it goes to back to the house, and then teens Jake and Robin, who, yeah, it's just like they're two of the teens at the halfway house, that are just there for the simple pleasure of watching them be murdered, are then they're watching a movie together, and they're watching A Place in the Sun with Montgomery Clift and Elizabeth Taylor. It's a great film. But, like, Jake is, like, trying to confess his feelings to her, and he's, like, stuttering through the whole thing, and he's obviously very nervous. And she shushes him, one of the most demoralizing things I've ever seen. And then when he finally gets it out, she laughs at him. Ew, poor Jakey. But, yeah, he then runs upstairs embarrassed, and then he's killed. He's cleaved in the head, as if this guy didn't already have a bad enough rap. They said, hey, man, hey, actor, you get to be rejected, and then you get to go upstairs and be murdered. Also, in a scene earlier, you have one line. I wouldn't have even been in that movie. You would have had to pay me a lot of money. But yeah, it only shows the swing of the cleaver. Doesn't show it connecting, because, of course, this movie was edited down to nothing. But yeah, then Robin, once the movie is over, goes to her room and undresses for no reason. They said, hey, be nude in this scene, even though it does not require. So that's the third pair of boobs you've seen in the movie. And then she's like, oh, Robin, you idiot. You handled that so poorly. And then she crawls into bed, only to find Jake's corpse there in bed with her. So she screams, but then is impaled through the bunk below with a machete. So she's dead. Again, these people are literally just here so they can be murdered. And it was a pretty decent kill, the impaling through the bed. So then the third teen, falling like dominoes, these teens are, that was supposed to watch Reggie. Also, Reggie, nowhere to be found. I think he's sleeping on a couch in the basement. No one's even watching him at all. He's Violet, who's like a goth teen, is shown in her room dancing. And her dancing is dangerously 80s, my friend. She's doing, like, the robot and the thing where they, like, mime and pull the rope. And it's crazy. And they keep showing her do the same dance moves over and over and over again for, like, a lot of time. This is, like, at least a minute and a half of the movie. It's just her dancing. It's a long time. But, yeah, and then she turns around and she's stabbed in the abdomen and she dies, you know. They said, hey, can you guys watch Reggie? And they're like, yeah, and they die immediately. So then Pam and Reggie return home, Pam returns home, and she wakes Reggie up, and then they all stumble upon the dead teens and decide to leave before being chased by none other than Jason. Like, this is the first time Jason has appeared in the entire movie. Jason hasn't even really been discussed. I think, Tommy hallucinated him twice, but that's it. So you don't even know if Jason's a killer, but then he literally bursts through the kitchen door, breaking it down. And you're like, oh, Tommy's not here. Jason is. Tommy must be Jason. And then Pam and Reggie are shown running in the woods for just a really long time. At least like 5 cuts. Like, it shows them running. Then it cuts to a different scene of them running through more woods. And that happens like 4 or 5 times. There's a bunch of frames of them just running. And then Pam, like, falls, and Reggie is gone. He just leaves her. He just keeps running. Doesn't stop. It's hilarious. And while running through the woods, Pam finds Matt, the director of the halfway house, pinned to a tree with a railroad spike through his forehead and his throat slit. So, like, that probably would have been a cool kill had it happened on screen. And you're literally, like, the way you feel is literally, like, oh, right, that guy. I kind of was wondering where he'd been. Excuse me. But not really, you know, because I barely knew he existed. But yeah, Pam finds her way back to the house where the body of Gramps is thrown through the window with his eyes gouged out. Which, that one honestly felt pretty stale. I don't think I needed an old man to be murdered and have his eyes gouged out. And then gone through a window. If he could have just, like, he's like, all right, I'm going home because I'm only a cook here. Good night. And then he just goes home and, you know, isn't in the rest of the movie. That would have been cool. I don't think I needed to see this harmless old sweet man who cooks people meals. I don't think I needed to see him murdered. But, yeah, that's like the fourth guy that's just had his eyes removed or his eye stabbed out. A lot of eye stabbing. But, yeah, this is like, this is a chunk of the movie where it's literally like 15 minutes of like a person being killed or a body being found like every minute and a half. It's insane. It's like so wham, bam, bam, bam that you almost become desensitized to it. It's pretty bananas. But yeah, then Jason chases Pam down and she falls and, you know, he's about to kill her. When Reggie, oh, they're outside at this time. Gramps comes through the window, and then Pam immediately runs back outside. Pam runs out of the house. She runs back in. I don't know what her plan is. But Reggie bursts onto the scene and saves Pam by knocking him over with a bulldozer. Don't know why there's a bulldozer at this halfway house. Don't even know why there's a barn in the back of the halfway house, too. No idea why. Don't know how Reggie knows how to drive a bulldozer, but he knocks Jason over with a bulldozer. And then they go and hide in the barn. Why is there a barn? Pam then finds a chainsaw, and her and Jason get into like a duel. And she slices him in the arm with a chainsaw. And you see Jason like bleed, and you see him kind of like recoil and like be wounded because he's obviously hurt. So this is an indication that it's not Jason resurrected, but a man. And you're like, oh. Could it be Tommy? Are we still supposed to think it's Tommy? But then guess what? Tommy shows up at the entrance to the barn after not being in the movie for like 25 minutes. You know, it reveals that he's not the killer before he and Jason exchange blows. You know what I mean? Like, he slices Tommy across the chest because Tommy is just so shocked to see him. Tommy thinks he's a hallucination. Jason just walks right up and slashes him in the chest. And he falls over. But then he stabs Jason in the leg with a pocket knife. Again, wounding him. Showing that he's like not the normal Jason. That he's a normal, that he's a regular guy. And that he wounds easily, kind of. But they all lure Jason up to the second floor of the barn. Where they then, after a brief struggle. I think Reggie knocks Jason off the edge of the barn, and he's like clinging by like his fingertips to the edge of the barn. And then Tommy comes in with the machete and delivers the final blow that sends Jason over the edge, and then he falls on a bed of spikes. Why is that on a farm except for threshing corn? What is that contraption? It literally seems like a bed of spikes to me. And then Jason is revealed to be Roy the paramedic. Even though you can't really tell that, because for some reason, they have for some reason when Roy slash Jason falls on the bed of spikes, his mask comes off, and like, you're like, who the hell is that guy? And you're like, and then the next scene, they're like, oh, that's Roy. Remember the paramedic Roy? Because, you know, but you know why it's so hard to tell it's Roy? It's because the guy on the bed of spikes, when Jason is unmasked, is played by the stuntman who played Jason, Tom Morga. Like, if you want people to understand that it's Roy, maybe you should use the actor that played Roy when you're unmasking him. Why would you use a totally different person? I know they'd look kind of similar, but, like, of course they're going to be like, well, who the hell is that? Because it's a person they literally haven't seen. But, yeah, Jason is revealed to be Roy the paramedic. And then the police guy with the hair, Sheriff Tucker, then heavy-handedly explains that Joey, the guy who was murdered by Vic, was actually Roy's son, and that Roy was out for revenge under the guise of Jason, because they found a bunch of Jason clippings in his wallet. So this guy, Roy, the paramedic, shows up, finds his son murdered, and then vows to kill everyone at the halfway house because he blames them for letting his son die, I guess. And then knowing that Jason is haunted, more or less, for lack of a better word, haunted the area, dons his outfit and, you know, his weapon and starts killing people just in order to enact his revenge. Incredibly convoluted. Honestly, almost defies logic. But, you know, that's what they went with. So Tommy, you know, because of his chest wound, is shown in the hospital afterwards. And he's still hallucinating Jason. You know, he looks in the mirror, he sees Jason. And Tommy, having been through so much more trauma at this point, I think they show, like, the hallucination of Jason disappear. So I think you're supposed to think that, like, Tommy and Jason have become, like, one or something. And then Tommy is shown going over to his desk drawer, and he pulls out the hockey mask. Why is that in Tommy's dresser drawer in the hospital? Why did they think he? Why did they take that off of Roy and then give it to Tommy? Why? Doesn't make any sense. But then, you know, it shows Pam out in the waiting room, and she hears the breaking of glass. And then Pam comes into Tommy's room, and then the door closes behind her, and behind the door is Tommy wearing the mask, and he charges at her with a knife, and, you know, it cuts to black, and that's the movie. So I think what they want you to think is that after all the everything Tommy has endured, he's now finally become the killer that we thought he was the entire movie, because they were trying to make you think that Tommy was the killer. And then he wasn't, but then now he is, because of how effed up he is. And that's the film, man. Like I said, insane. Had it been unedited, I think, had it been helmed by a better director, perhaps this could have been actually a very good movie. Because I think in its bones, it is what, like, people come to slasher movies to see, which is just, you know, they set people up just to see them knocked down. And AKA knocked down, I mean, killed, you know, in creative, fun ways. And I don't know why people like it. I don't know why I like it. Can't explain it. Somebody psychoanalyze me and tell me why. I don't know. But, like, yeah, it's just an interesting film for sure. And there's a lot to love about it, because it's, like, it's so bizarre and weird and defies all logic and really just makes you think and makes you try to figure this movie out. Even though there's no figuring it out, because no one bothered to try to figure it out in the first place. So yeah, I think the best kills of this movie are Tina with the garden shears and through her eyes, and then, you know, Vinny with the road flare through the mouth. And you're probably like, who's Vinny? Again, who's in the movie for like 30 seconds. So many characters. I think up until this point, this was the most kills in a Friday the 13th movie here. I kept a tally throughout the entire movie. So let's see. Let's go for a kill count here. We got Joey, Pete, Vinny, Billy, Lana, Eddie, Tina, the Drifter, Demon, Anita, Robin, Jake, Violet. Oh, and I forgot to mention, while they're running through the woods, they come to the road. Like, while Reggie and Pam are running through the woods from Jason, they come to the road. And they come across an ambulance, and the other paramedic is in there dead with his throat slashed. Why? Who knows? That should have been a dead giveaway right there, that there was Roy the paramedic, because where is he? But yeah, that EMT, Matt, Gramps, and then Roy. So let's see this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. 17 people killed. 16 of them by Roy. So I think that's the highest kill count so far in a Friday the 13th movie. I think it might be surpassed later, maybe in, like, Jason Takes Manhattan, because there's a lot of kills in that one. But yeah, so, like, just to wrap up before we get to the trivia and the, you know, production notes, and we say our goodbyes, I'll and a movie like this is good for this kind of stuff, unanswered questions. So Roy, using Jason as a guise to commit his murders, he really went to the extreme, didn't he? because in this movie, Jason, when he appears, is bald. He's a bald man. So that's because they want you to think that it's actually Jason, I think, for a second. They want you to think it's like Jason resurrected. So it's like a bald man. It's like a bald-looking stunt man. Because Jason was bald. But then it's revealed that it was Roy, and he was using, like, weird prosthetics and, like, had, like, a plastic rubber silicone bald head. And it's just, like, who did they want? Like, first of all, how would Roy have the ability to even do that? Where did he get this mask? Where did he make this this fake bald head? Like, who? Like, I'm confused as to who I was supposed to think was the killer. Because, like, as soon as I see a bald Jason, I think, oh, it can't be Tommy. Or maybe it could be Tommy. Because Tommy could make, like, a bald prosthetic Jason head like that. But I think most people are going to be like, oh, it's Jason resurrected. But then you have it be Roy. And it's just like, why couldn't you just show a Jason, like, with hair? And then I would think, oh, it's not Jason, it's Tommy or Roy. But, like, it's like they also wanted you to think it was secretly, like, a resurrected Jason. And it's just like there were too many possibilities, I think, for who the killer could have been. And they were trying to go too many directions with it. And, like, I don't know, where was Tommy that entire time then? If he actually wasn't going around killing people, where was he? Just literally sitting under a tree in the rain for 30 minutes of the movie? If you think about this movie, Tommy doesn't speak. He barely speaks. He's barely even in the movie. It's insane. Why was Reggie the Reckless always there? Sir, if your grandpa works there, why are you there at night? Why did Roy kill all of these people? Roy, if you wanted to take revenge for your son's murder, the murderer was right there in police custody. You were right next to him. You could have had easy access to him, killed him. You killed everyone at the halfway house who wasn't responsible for your son's murder. And, like, in what world does the father of a murdered child go on a killing spree where he kills 16 people in the most violent and brutal ways possible? Like, Roy, a seemingly normal paramedic, turns on people and then murders them. Gruesomely. Like, one day he was a normal dad. They try to say, like, oh yeah, he never really talked much to the other paramedics. But a quiet guy doesn't then become a vicious, brutal murderer, stabbing people through the eyes with garden shears, killing random people. A lot of these people didn't even have anything to do with the murderer. I had no idea who his son Joe even was. He killed those two innocent greasers who were just only guilty of being obnoxious. He killed Billy and Lana. What did they do? Like, there's no logic to this movie, and that's what makes it so fun, I think, but that's also what makes it very, very kind of frustrating and confusing. And, like, it's shown at the end that Roy had a picture of Joey in his wallet, but the picture of Joey looked like it had been taken literally yesterday. Sir, if you ran away so long ago, and if Joey's mom died in childbirth, who gave you this picture? They just really wanted to convince you. They were like, yeah, he's Joey's father, all right. Look, he has a picture of him. Even though that doesn't make any sense. Why did Tommy suddenly become a killer now? After not even really witnessing a single murder this entire movie, but, like, you know, he wasn't that traumatized to become a murderer when he literally murdered Jason in cold blood and watched a bunch of people get killed in the last movie. Just, you know, little something. All right, so we'll finish up here with some production notes, some IMDb trivia that I found that I thought was interesting. So straight off the Wikipedia page, you know, going to read some interesting things about casting. When they were casting this movie, many of the actors in the film didn't know it was a Friday the 13th movie. John Sheppard, who plays Tommy, like I said, spent several months volunteering at a state mental hospital to prepare for the role, and then was apparently incredibly disappointed to discover that the movie he thought he was in was actually the Friday the 13th, but number 5. So he prepared for this psychological thriller and then found out that he was in a schlocky slasher film. Schlocky slasher. Sorry. Oh, yeah. But yeah, so that's crazy. Imagine how disappointed all those people were to find out they were part of the Friday the 13th movie, part 5. And then they were just like, after it came out, they were like, oh, God. It's even worse than I remember. So also, interesting fact that the hockey mask in this movie worn by the killer has a different design than previous installments. So in this one, there are two blue stripes under the eyes of the hockey mask. And that's to indicate that the person wearing the hockey mask is Roy. Whereas when Tommy's hallucinating Jason, and as well as every other entry in the series, there are 3 red stripes. So, like, in this movie, if you're looking at Jason, like Jason, like the hallucination of Jason, which is the real one because it's in Tommy's memories, he has red stripes on his mask. But if you see the killer with the blue, that's how you know that it's Roy. As far as the casting of Jason goes, he was played by Tom Morga, who is a stuntman who's actually played Leatherface as well as Michael Myers. So he's the only actor to do all three, I think. But he was, in the last movie, Jason was played by Ted White, who was offered the opportunity to reprise his role in the sequel, but he turned it down. Even though later he later regretted doing that. I don't know why he regretted not being in this movie, but he was a terrific Jason in the last movie. I think Ted White's probably like my second favorite actor to play Jason. And guess what? My first one is not Kane Hodder. Another interesting fact that the sex scene between Eddie and Tina in the woods was supposed to be 3 minutes, and it was filmed. But they had to cut it down to 10 seconds because of the MPAA. Also, interestingly enough, the woman who played Tina was named Deborah Voorhees. That's most of the reason why she was cast. And I guess in a 2013 interview, Deborah Voorhees revealed that her being nude in this film got her fired from teaching jobs at 2 separate places years later. So, yeah, I guess at one of the high schools she tried to get a job at, boys got a hold of her topless images and then texted them around school. So I don't know if that's necessarily fair to her, but, definitely, I don't know. I guess nudity does kind of, being nude in a film does kind of, I don't know, have repercussions later. This one was interesting. This one goes with what I was saying earlier. Without counting laughing or yelling, Tommy Jarvis only says 24 words in the entire movie. Supposedly your main character only says 24 words. Originally, Corey Feldman was supposed to reprise his role as Tommy Jarvis, but he couldn't because of Goonies. Although that wouldn't have made any sense. Because Corey Feldman was still like a little kid at this point, so to see him do this kind of stuff, I think would have been not that great. I'm glad they cast with an older actor. Although I wish he had a better written part. There were 16 scenes featuring sex or graphic violence that had to be edited down in order to earn a R rating instead of an X from the MPAA. And that required 9 trips to the MPAA before finally getting that R rating. Apparently, actress Melanie Kinnaman and director Danny Steinmann did not get along during the production. And Kinnaman, who plays Pam, said that Danny Steinmann was hostile and unapproachable as a director. Which I can see that happening. He doesn't necessarily seem like a stand-up guy, although you shouldn't speak ill of the dead, I know, but seems kind of like a creep. This is actually apparently the only film in the series where Jason, or the first film in the series, I should say, where Jason is referred to by his full name, Jason Voorhees. In the original and then final chapter, he's only referred to as Jason. Okay, sorry here. John Sheppard wore cowboy boots in order to look taller. I think that's just plain funny. Sherilyn Fenn was considered for the role of Violet, but turned it down to do just one of the guys. Sherilyn Fenn from Twin Peaks was almost a girl who had one scene in this movie where she dances for a long time and is murdered. From what I've read, after the filming of Friday the 13th Part 5, director Danny Steinmann was lined up to direct a further 5 movies, but they all fell through. And he was then involved in a horrible bicycle accident that almost killed him. And he spent many years recuperating from it and never returned to filmmaking. And then I think he passed away in 2015 or something like that. And yeah, New Beginning had more deaths and more nudity than any previous installment. Juliet Cummins, who played Robin, was a U.S. Olympic gymnast for 14 years before getting into acting. So that's just plain interesting. They don't work that all into the film. But what can you do? But yeah, so that's about it. That's all I got for you here. Oh, okay. Well, okay. This one is kind of crass, but I guess I'll say it anyway. Deborah Voorhees was voted as number 1 on the list of the top 12 boobs of the Friday the 13th franchise by website Icon versus Icon on October 25th, 2015. So if you care about that stuff, there it is. But yeah, this movie, it was so different from every Friday the 13th movie, you know. Jason is barely mentioned. He's almost not invoked by name. I think the sheriff is just like, oh, it's Jason Voorhees. And there is a weird scene where the sheriff is talking to some higher up big wig executive, maybe the mayor of the town or something. And he's like, I think this is Jason Voorhees. And he's like, you're crazy. Jason Voorhees is dead. But aside from that, That trail, that line of thinking, not followed anywhere. Jason Voorhees is never really mentioned by Pam or Matt or anybody, because there's no communication between characters. None of these characters talk about what's going on at all. They're not like, oh, I wonder who's doing this. I wonder who's getting murdered. Because they only realize that murders are happening in the last 10 minutes of this movie. It just feels like such a different slasher film than a Friday the 13th. It feels like... I just don't understand this. The script is mind-boggling. Because at no point are they like, let's band together. Someone's taking us out. It doesn't happen. They don't even really talk about the fact that someone's going around killing people. Because that's the thing, because all the kills in this movie, the first, several kills are, not even related to, the halfway house. Like, there's the greasers, and then there's the couple at the diner. And, like, of course the police are like, what's going on? But, like, there's so many murders that happen at the halfway house. And they only really happen within, like, the span of, like, a couple of hours. So many people are killed. Everyone at this halfway house, except for, like, three people, is killed within, like, maybe, like, 5 hours. So there isn't even time for someone to be like, who's doing this? Do you think it's Jason? Is Jason back? There's no time to even speculate. Because it's just boom, boom, boom. It's just, and, like, I think what they were trying to do, of course, is, like, do almost not, like, an anthology thing, but, like, just switch it up and be like, hey, Tommy's the killer now. We need the series to go somewhere, but we want the final chapter to have the heft that it should, and we want Jason to stay dead, and we want Tommy to be the new killer, but people hated it. People didn't go for it at all. So, as you know, Friday the 13th, Part 6, Jason Lives, just has Jason become resurrected, and he's the main antagonist, like, for the rest of the movies. Which, of course, I love. I'm glad they did that. Part 6 is a great movie. But, like, I can appreciate what they were trying to do, too. I just think they kind of fumbled it a little bit. And this certainly isn't a movie that continues or carries a franchise. This is a movie that's so silly and bizarre that it, you know, almost killed a franchise. But I think it's a good part of an installment, too. What did I even just say? I think it's a good installment in a good series. Like, this movie isn't, like, at the top of my list, but it's certainly, if you divide my list into movies in a series that are, like, good and watchable, this is still definitely one of them. And I think people really, really, really have a lot of hate for this movie. And I can't understand why, because I do think it's a lot of fun. It does have its champions, though, like, on Reddit and stuff, and I think that's really cool. That makes me very happy. So ultimately, if you're interested to know, my current Friday the 13th rankings, I have, you know, ranked 1 through 10 here, because I still have to watch Freddy versus Jason and then the remake. But I'll tell you my rankings right now. If you're interested, you know, if you want to start a discussion about which are the best, which are the worst, I think that'd be very cool. I love to hear people's opinions about this stuff. So if you want to argue with me, you know, just write in. Number 10, part 8, Jason Takes Manhattan. I know that's got to be controversial, because some people really love that movie. A lot of people really do, but I think it's just kind of a slog, you know? I think no one in that movie is killed in an interesting way, really, like, at all, except for that guy who's drowned in that thing of toxic waste, but that's at the very end, and it's like an hour and 45 minute movie. It's kind of like the longest Friday the 13th movie. And it's just, doesn't even take place in New York. And I can't stand all these characters. Like, none of the acting is good. And also it screws up the timeline because it like, the main character, Rennie, even though she's, like, 18, she had a run-in with Jason when he was a little boy, even though Jason was a little boy in, like, the 1950s. And she, in this movie, takes place in, like, 1990. So, like, the math doesn't add up. And, of course, they're not even in Manhattan for most of the movie. They're on a boat. So that one fell flat for me. I remember liking that one a lot, but this time didn't really. Then, number 9, Jason X. Oh, man. This movie was tough. It's so extremely Canadian. I just think it's a tough time. It's a tough watch. Like, you're waiting for Uber Jason to come along, but he's only in the last, like, 15 minutes of the movie. And it's a really interesting premise. They just kind of bungled, I think. Alexa Doig is really good. She's phenomenal. You know, a David Cronenberg cameo is hilarious. And Kane Hodder, always consistently a pretty good Jason. But, like, I don't know. It's just, like, the plot of this one is bizarre. And it's bad, I think. There's only, like, one good kill in the movie, and a lot of, it's just, like, it's trying so hard to be funny, and it's just not. Part 8, or, like, not part 8, but my number 8 is the final Friday, Jason Goes to Hell. And that's, you know, a lot of people hate that one, too, because it introduces supernatural elements, and, like, you know, how Jason has a family, and, like, Jason dies in the beginning of the movie, and he's not really in it. Like, if you, like, people hate when Jason's not in a movie. Like, they couldn't stand it in Part 5. They hated it in Jason Goes to Hell the Final Friday. And people don't even like 1 because Jason's not in it. But yeah, so even though Jason isn't really in this one, when Jason is in this one, it's great. And I think the kills in this one are really creative and really kind of interesting and disgusting. So, especially if you watch the unrated version, it's a pretty entertaining movie. And number 7 would be Part 5, A New Beginning. So this is where we get into the category where it's hard to rank. Because, like, my 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 are all movies that I love in this franchise. And I can watch them any time of day. But I would say, compared to other installments, Part 5 is weaker. But it's not less fun, if that makes sense. Part 7, The New Blood, is also in this realm. Because it's not particularly well made, but it is very fun and very interesting. And just, like, I love the characters and the vibe in this one, too. It's very similar to the early ones because they're around Crystal Lake. And it's, like, a little less, like, meta humor. It's not really trying to be as funny. It kind of seems like it's getting back to the Friday the 13th roots. So I really like this one, too. My number 5 ranking is Part 2. I know people are going to clash. I know people are going to clash with me on that one. And I mean, it's like, it's so hard to rank when you get into these final 5. Because Part 2 is really good. I mean, Ginny, I think, is probably Ginny, I think, is my favorite final girl in the Friday the 13th franchise. But I think up until that last, like, 20 minutes with Ginny and Paul and Jason, I think the movie is kind of boring. A little slow. Like, no characters that you like are being killed, really. It's just characters that you find obnoxious. But it was a worthy follow-up to Part 1, definitely. Steve Miner, I think, knows how to do these movies right. My number 4 is Part 6, Jason Lives, just because it introduced, like, the zombie, unstoppable Jason that we all know and love. And the premise is pretty good. You know, Tommy Jarvis has to fight a resurrected Jason at Crystal Lake, and there's campers again, and it's just it's like meta humor, and it's like really leans into the silliness, and like the tons of kills that like makes these movies famous. Part 3 in 3D is my number 3. Again, a lot of the same stuff as Part 2. Jason gets the hockey mask in this one, and it's just like characters with personalities getting murdered, and I think that's great. At one point, the one guy gets his head squeezed and his eyeball pops out. It looks horrible, but I love it. See, now my number 2 is The Final Chapter, and I know people are going to be like, what? The original is your favorite? But yeah, I think the original is my favorite. I think because the MPAA was non-existent at this point. The kills in this movie are so graphic and gory. Kevin Bacon's in it. And you truly don't know who the killer is at this point. And the story is phenomenal. And there's, like, real suspense. And it started everything off, you know? I mean, it's the first time we hear Harry Manfredini's suspenseful music, you know? We get the Crystal Lake setting, you know? We get teenagers setting up a camp. And it's just great. But, of course, Final Chapter is amazing, too. A lot of great stuff in Final Chapter. But, so that's my rankings. You know, let me know what you think of them. And I really just hope you enjoyed, our discussion about Friday the 13th Part 5. And sorry, I ran very long tonight. Didn't mean to, but, I could talk about these movies for hours. So I'm not even going to tell you what movie's going to be next. But just know The Awakening with Charlton Heston and John Frankenheimer's Prophecy are coming soon. I thank you for listening. Thank you for giving me your time this evening or morning or wherever you're listening. I appreciate it very much, and I will see you next time. And I hope you have a terrific day or night, whatever the case may be. All right.